undercover boss. Big thing. On Friday night, it was Modell Sporting Goods. And the last person that the president of the company, last store that he went to, was in the nation's capital, was Washington, D.C. And it so happened that one of the associates that he was supposed to work with was black. And he was disguised as being one who was getting ready to open up a sporting goods store because his character was that he failed in a pizza shop. But the young lady that was to train him got to talking after she was showing him everything, and he was impressed the way she was going. And they got to talking. And she asked him a question. What happened in your business? And he told her. The young lady said, I want you to understand something. Don't ever give up. Don't ever give up. Whatever you're going through, don't ever give up. And she looked him in the eye and says, you see me? I've been a shelter for 3 years. Still in a shelter. But I haven't given up. I've got 3 kids. And they both started crying, and you know me. I'm crying right with them. And then when she told the story, yeah, this man who weighs almost 300 pounds as president, tears coming down his face. But when you all were invited to come to the Met Stadium in New York, they didn't know why they were coming. She was the last one, and when she found out that he was the president of the company, she could not believe it. Could not believe it. He was so fascinated with how she never gave up that he gave her a check for $250,000 to buy herself a home for her kids so that she will never ever have to live in a shelter. A couple of lessons to learn from that. And I'm going to point this to my young people. Wherever you are working, don't care if you're scrubbing floors, because you never know who's going to walk in and hear your plight.
Amen. Amen.
Do your best and don't complain. She never complained. And that tells me that somewhere in her background, she knows a man named Jesus.
That's right.
That's a testimony right there. I'm sitting there and I'm crying worse than all they were crying. And when he fell, when she fell to her knees, he fell to his knees right beside her, asking, are you all right? Are you all right? God always has somebody in the mix for
you. Yes.
That you never knew.
Yes.
Will come your way. But you can't ever give up. Can't give up. Can't give up. Sister Virgie testified this morning about that.
Amen.
My head was killing me.
But the Lord,
came in the room.
Had his own way.
Huh?
Had his own way.
That's all I got to say. Come on, Father.
Come on, Father.
Thank you. your name and where you're from.
Amen. Amen.
Good afternoon, Red Ball, our Second Baptist Church. My name is
Mary Ann,
and I'm
Rose's
sister.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm Ann Steve Pueblo. I'm here with my wife, Lindley, and my son, Steven. We're originally from South Columbia, South Carolina. And it's just a blessing to be here. I'm thankful because, you know, we literally just came in last couple of days ago. And like any of you want to find a temporary church home and do it on Sunday. And because my wife, thanks to technology, she found the Second Baptist Church.
All right. Amen. 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 All right,
church.
Amen. You are welcome
here. You are loved here. You are part of God's family. The table's prepared, and you know that we care. Come on. Come on, you are loved. Come on, you are welcome in this place. All of the sweet, sweet spirit. Amen.
What was that song?
Thank you.
I'll give you all the glory.
Every day.
Some of the time.
Yes.
Every day that I live, I'll give you all the glory. That's good news.
Amen.
Good news.
Amen.
Thank you, choir. The reading of God's word is found in the Old Testament, Proverbs 3.
Proverbs.
Verses 5 and 6. Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6. Reads thusly, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he,
yes, he will.
Nobody else but he, shall direct thy path. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy written as we listen to the instruments as they play the hymn of meditation. That we come into Holy of Holies as we listen to God's word. Thank you.
preaching time now. Come on, preacher. Come on, preach.
That's all right.
Amen.
I'm so glad that Deacon Buster's back in the house.
Amen.
Spirit of a living God, and let it fall fresh on me. Melt me, mold me, and fill me. Spirit of a living God, fall fresh on me. Amen.
Amen.
The reading of the word came from the King James. But every night, here I have to go to the message.
Amen. Christian.
And the message reads that passage this way. Trust God from the bottom of your heart.
Yes.
Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do. Everywhere you go, he's the one.
Yes.
He's the one who will keep you on track. This afternoon, this is not what I ordered. This is not what I ordered. Have you ever ordered a menu item at a restaurant only to learn that what you received wasn't what you ordered? Where were you? Were you at a cafeteria? Fancy restaurant standing in line at Mickey D's? It does not matter, church, where you were when it happened. It's the results that trouble you the most.
Yes.
You didn't get what you ordered.
All right, all right.
And you know how we are. When we don't get what we order, we're about ready to turn the whole restaurant inside and out. Down versus side by side.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Come on. Come on.
It's really frustrating to pull up to a drive-thru and order your Whopper.
Oh, come on now.
Or your Big Mac by the numbers, and only learn that the cashier didn't get it right. There are a few things, church, that make your order distasteful.
All right.
So your request that they hold those items and you were the one that asked him to hold the pickles and to cut your hamburger in half. You asked for Pepsi and not Coke.
Come on.
If you like most people, there have been a few times where you received everything you didn't want.
That's right.
And none of what you really ordered. That's when you mash the button or peck on the window and say, excuse me, but this is not what I ordered. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But y'all not gonna say it like that. Y'all not gonna say it, I cleaned it up for you. You're not gonna say it like that. Especially when you get one of our Nubian sisters.
Yes.
All great.
From the hood that explains it to you in their terminology.
Yes.
It's the same way in the restaurant. The steak you ordered was to be cooked well done, but when it was delivered, it was rare with the blood oozing out. You didn't ask for brown gravy, instead of white gravy. They are both white, but there is a big difference between ranch dressing and blue cheese dressing. Oh, yes, it is. That's when you tell your waitress, this is not what I ordered. And then, church, there are the times that a friend talks you into ordering unfamiliar ethnic foods from a menu with no pictures.
Oh, man.
What is this stuff called Wu Chang anyway? You make your entry into the social circles of the elite and notice that there is no fried chicken, no rice and gravy, no baked potatoes on the menu. What do you do? You listen to the order of the person sitting at the next table and order a serving of caviar and escargot. But when the waiter brings it to your table, you look at it and you see fresh eggs, fish eggs, and snails, and you choke and ask, is this what I ordered? Somebody knows what I'm talking about.
Come on, preacher.
And sometimes, church, that's the way it is in life.
Yeah.
We don't often get life the way we want it.
Yeah.
And sometimes, church, we get what we order and don't like what we receive.
Come on, man.
In our youth, we are very specific about what we want.
Yeah.
But it seems somehow that we didn't get the right order. And someone else got our order and we got theirs. We ordered the big house, but not this one.
Yeah.
We ordered the mansion, but not this one. We ordered the easy life, flying around the world in first class section of jet plane. We ordered an unlimited checking account and designer clothes that we were only once to throw them away. We ordered luxury cars and health and eternal youth. That's what we ordered, remember?
Yeah. Come on, man.
But when we look into the bag of experiences that life has given us, we are often discouraged when it turns out that the very few experiences we asked for ends up in our bag. Now at 25, 45, 65, and 75, we're asking, is this what I ordered?
Yeah.
What happened to that fine, sexy model I said I was going to marry? What happened to that? What happened to that macho Superman with rippling muscles and washboard abs that I said would sweep me off my feet? Did somebody else get my order?
Come on, man.
Yeah. Unfortunately, life is not like Burger King, where you can have it your way. We don't have that option of going through heaven's drive-through window and ordering the kind of life we will live on earth. We can't pick what color we'll be. Whether we'll be tall or short, or whether we live life trouble-free, we don't get that choice from the menu. Life number one, number two, number three, with an extra side order of things we like best. It just doesn't work that way.
Amen. Come on, preacher.
But we have come to learn more about God as Christians.
Yeah.
We have learned that life is not like ordering a value meal. Help me, somebody. No matter what we order, it's sure to come up short.
Yeah.
Sometimes, church, we'll be missing. Those who know the Lord have learned to let God decide what's best for us.
Yes, sir.
As we mature spiritually, we don't ask what happened to life our Lord. And now we say all of my steps.
Yes, sir.
So I can live a life you have given me according to your will. Not my will, but according to your will.
Yes, sir.
In this text of Proverbs, we find Solomon. Solomon points to the importance of allowing God to direct our lives instead of self-destruction. Solomon was the third king of Israel. He is respected as a man who possessed great wisdom. But most of his wisdom was given to him by God. However, some of his wisdom was learned in the school of hard knocks. You can't learn all you know by just being in the Ivy League culture. Most of us learn what we know in the neighborhood. Because what you learn in the hood will take you through life, some of it. As a very young man, Solomon became king of Israel. He recognized the enormity of his position and prayed for guidance. One night while he slept, God appeared to him in a dream and gave him the opportunity to wish for anything he wanted as king. God promised to give him whatever he wanted. It was a chance to pick life the way he wanted. Down to the smallest detail, riches, fame, possession, anything else available to him if he wanted. But in 1 Kings 3:9, he decided that it would be best to have an understanding heart and let God lead him.
Come on, man.
Sometimes, church, you got to let God lead you.
Amen. Amen.
You just can't do things on a whim.
That's right.
Just because you want to do it.
Come on, man.
And much of the book of Proverbs is a collection of wisdom of Solomon.
Amen.
It reflects, church, what he has been given by God through revelation and what he learned through the experiences of his life. Proverbs chapter 3 refers to one of the great truths about life that Solomon learned and reduced to a mere proverb. Solomon says, you gotta trust in the Lord.
That's right.
With all thy heart, not with some of your heart. You gotta trust him with all of your heart and lean.
Come on, man.
Not to your own understanding. Because your own understanding gets you in trouble.
Amen. Every time.
Because you some stuff you still don't understand. And you still lean into it.
Amen.
In all thy ways, it says, acknowledge him and he will direct thy path. Yes. We think on it now. What it simply says is this. Let God set your course.
Come on now.
Rather than picking your own direction.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever we are to make choices about what we do in life, we need to consult him. And he will direct us to the path that we should take.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, I'm getting ready. I need some air in here, man. I'm sweating up here already. I need some air. I'm soaking wet already. What if we could really have our way? Suppose we could get on our knees at night and hear God say to us what he said to Solomon, have it your way, order a life any way you choose. What would be your result? Most of us would order a whopper of a life. Oh, yes, we would. It would be a Mac life. But whoppers and Big Macs are big, but they also are packaged with everything on them.
Yeah.
Most of us couldn't enjoy having a whopper of a Mac life because there are too many things on it that we just don't like.
Come on, man.
We just don't like. If we could order a Mac life for ourselves, we would delete anything that has an element of bitterness to it. That means we would, number one, hold the mayonnaise. Why hold the mayonnaise? Because mayonnaise is made mostly of egg yolks, lots of oil, but made mostly of lemon juice, oil, and powdered onions. Lemon juice is bitter. Onions are mostly bitter because the eggs and mayonnaise can go bad if left unrefrigerated. We want nothing that can possibly go bad with us. Plus, it's bitter. So we say, hold the mayonnaise. Number two, some of us say, hold the mustard. Mustard is made by grinding tiny mustard seeds into a powder and mixing it with spices. Jesus said, if we could move mountains, if we had the faith of one mustard seed.
That's right, that's right.
That's what he said. So you would think that the life we order would contain a life by faith.
Amen.
Think about that. Not so, because mustard is made by mixing the mustard seed with vinegar and spices. That means, church, living by faith could be a little tough to swallow. So we say, hold the mustard. I'm going somewhere with this.
Let's go. Come on. Come on.
Number three. A lot of us say, hold the pickles. A pickle is actually a cucumber. Numbers 11:5 says that the children of Israel loved cucumbers. They often ate them raw, but however, a pickle is a cucumber that has been through a whole lot.
Come on, man.
It has been through a whole lot. Pickles have endured vinegar, salt, pickling lime, and much more. In life, when we lose our health, we are in a pickle. As soon as we lose our health, we go down faster than anybody, and we inject the pickle. Oh, the Lord, why did the Lord do this to me? And when we lose our money, woo, we are really in a pickle. I lost my paycheck from the church. Couldn't find it nowhere. I tore that house upside down looking for that paycheck. Have not found it to this day. I was in a pickle. I ain't gonna say what else I was in, but I was in a pickle. And then I had to hear it from my wife. Oh, Mr. Perfect. Don't lose nothing. Always got your receipts. Always got this. You never lose nothing. I was in a pickle. And you know, when my wife goes, she goes like, yabba dabba doo. But if you lose your job, you are really in a pickle. Why they let me go? Huh? I'm one of the faithful ones. I'm always, why me? And when we choose the life we want for ourselves, we say, hold the pickle. Number four, hold the onion. Onions add taste to recipes, but when you cut into an onion, it releases substance that forms sulfuric acid and turns it into gas. These gases can be mixed with the water in your eyes and turn into a mild form of sulfuric acid. To get rid of the acids that you could harm your eyes, your brain sends out a signal that makes you cry. But the crying is good for eyes because without the tears, the acid would burn your eyes. If you live in this life, you will have some crying time. Oh yes, you will. You will have to cry sometime. If you go through this life and the trials and tribulations that you have, oh, you will cry sometime. My wife asked me every Friday night, why in the world do you torture yourself and look at an undercover boss? I cry every Friday night. I don't care what And when she comes to the house, I try to man up. But she already knows the deal. You got to cry sometimes.
Amen.
You try to prepare yourself for something that will be good, but the sulfuric acids of worry, the acids of pain, and the anxiety gets in your eyes, and we just have to cry. And many see light that has crying and tears, and they say, hold the onions. But not only that, church, you got to hold the tomatoes too. Because when you hold babies, because they are slippery and slimy, and they look too ugly. Slippery and slimy. They just look too ugly. So you gotta hold the tomatoes. Then you gotta hold the ketchup, because it's got tomatoes in it and it looks just like blood. Doesn't it? And then you gotta hold the lettuce, because it's green and it's raw, and I need nothing in my life that is raw.
Come on now, come on now.
We don't want nothing in our life that's raw. If it's not sweeter than the berry, we can't have it. But when we remove everything we don't like about life, all is left is meat and bread. When Israel wandered in the wilderness, church, they ate quail meat and bread for years. Then they complained because they wanted cucumbers, they wanted onions, they wanted garlic, and all the other things that they had missed. They were never satisfied. And there are even some who don't like the meat because they are vegetarian, so they eat veggie burgers. Oh, my. But with all the extras and the meat, there is nothing left but bread. Then we hear the word of God declare, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. In this life, church, we're going to need some mayonnaise. In this life, we're going to need some mustard. In this life, we're going to need some pickles. In this life, we're going to need some onions. In this life, we're going to need some tomatoes. In this life, we're going to need some ketchup. In this life, church, we're going to need some lettuce.
Come on.
That's probably why God won't let us have it our way. It takes some of the things we don't like about life to make it worth living and give us the substance that we need.
Yes, sir. Come on, preacher.
And finally.
Finally.
We should consider the wisdom of Solomon about our life.
Yes.
Because Solomon says, lean not to your own understanding, but ask God and he will direct our paths.
Yes, he will.
If we ask God, church, to prepare a path for our lives, be assured that God will not give us a plain life. It may have a little of everything in it. You see, church, God will not give us a lot of sunshine and often a little rain. He'll give us a little happiness, and sometimes he'll give us a little pain. He'll give us an hour to smile and a few minutes of trouble. He'll give us a bed to sleep in and the children to make the joys double. But when God gives you a mountain, remember there's always a valley around the way. If God orders us a moment of sadness, he'll throw on a happy day. We wouldn't like it if the sun always shined and night never came. Come on, somebody. If we were always victorious and won every day. But the life that God gives us is not from Burger King. The life that God gives us is from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's a difference, church, between Mickey D's and the Masters of the Sea. At the drive-thru with that Burger King, if you ask to pay for it, you can get your order supersized. If you order it supersized, you get a few more fries. They double size. that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Oh, that's good news, church. Oh, that's good news. That means that an obedient saint whose life is ordered in the will of God does not have to ask to pay for anything actually. Oh, that's good news. His life is automatically suicide. But God told Malachi that for those who are obedient, that he will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing more than you would ever have or ever receive. That's good news, church. That means, church, if we are obedient, you don't have to ask for it. Because God will automatically supersize your blessing. That's good news. That's good news. Because Samson was obedient, God supersized his strength. And he became the strongest man in the world. Because Solomon was obedient, God supersized his wisdom. And he was the wisest of all. Because Methuselah was obedient, God supervised his size and life to live 960 years.
Yes,
but David was obedient, and God supersized his humility, and he became known as a man after God's own house.
That's right, that's right.
Because Hezekiah was obedient, God supersized his life and gave him 50 more years. But I'm gonna go better than that. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were obedient in the fiery furnace. But God supersized everything. And when he supersized it, they heard the writer said, oh, there's a fourth man in there. And his name is Jesus. Ah, what a mighty God you serve. That's good news, sir. Good news. And I'm here to let you know that God can supersize our blessings too.
Oh, yes, he can.
He supersized the joys of our family. He supersized our health and strength. He supersized our business and finance. He supersized the strength of our marriage. But that's not the best part. I want to let you know something here this afternoon, that at Burger King, you have to pay for extra. But when the saint goes to the window of heaven, he or she hears the word, you can't pay for your blessing because Jesus has paid it all. I ask for nothing. I give you everything. I give you my body. I give you my soul. I fixed up my hair. I cast my feet from you. I had a spear in my side. I had a thorns on my head. I ask nothing. Good news. Good news.
Good news.
Jesus. The Lord. Jesus, the lily of the valley. Jesus, the bright and morning star. But on the third day,
yes, sir.
On the third day,
yeah.
He got up. He got up with all power in his hand on the land. You can't ask for more.
Suicide.
Don't ask you for the time.
Yes, sir. Paid it off.
Yes, sir.
Paid it all for you and me. That's why all of this month we'll be celebrating the resurrection. We're into the Lenten season right now. But when we think about the cross, when we think about his goodness and his mercy, we can't help but serve him. The doors of the church are open.
Oh, yeah.
If you're searching for a church home, and you're tired of just doing things the other way, and you need to find a better way, you need to find a way that he doesn't charge you nothing for you. He doesn't charge you a thing. All he asks you to do is come as you are. Come be a part of the household of faith. That's good news. Because when you gather together with the fellowship of Christians, you can't help but have joy overflowing in your veins. Good news. Good news. The church is a hospital for sick people. And also someone over there been in here in a while is still a house of a hospital. We all strive in every day to be more like Jesus. Is there one? Is there one? Is there one? Don't let it go by. Don't let it go by that you can walk out here before you get to the step. There it is. Walk, drive down Costa Drive. Bam! There it is. Time is too short to let it go by. Maybe so. To get y'all out of here by 1 or 2. I'm just 15 over today. Please forgive me.
You can go next week. Next week.
It's good. But y'all just keep us in prayer. Keep the church in prayer. And keep the government folk in prayer. And keep Fairfax County in prayer. That they keep all moving in the way that they're moving.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. So we do what we're supposed to do.
That's right.
Amen. So we can let our folk. And I don't think we're going to have a problem in the community.
Oh,
because it's already done.
That's right.
So we just have to go through the formality. We're ready for our closing. Shall we stand?
Everybody
say amen.
God
has spoken.
So let the church,
say amen.
Yeah. Can I get a witness?
Let the church say amen.
To what his plans are.
Let the church
to what his word says.